Okay, so let's talk about compensating curves. Before discussing compensating curves, we have to learn about Hanau's quint. Hanau's quint has five major components. First is inclination of condylar guidance, inclination of plane of orientation, inclination of incisor guidance, height of cusp, and fifth is compensating curve. Now, how compensating curves work, why they are called as compensating curves, and what are different type of compensating curves, we will see. So this is natural dentition. In the coronal section, if you see maxilla from anterior to posterior, the inclination of teeth changes. The molars are tilted buccally. They are inclined buccally. Whereas in mandible, if we go posteriorly, the molars are inclined lingually. And in sagittal section, as we go posteriorly, the maxillary molars are inclined distally and the mandibular molars are inclined mesially. Why is that? Because of this. See the direction of this medial pterygoid muscle, right? The long axis of posterior teeth are parallel to the direction of muscle. Why? So that they can bear the maximum load along the long axis, and in this way, they can bear the maximum load, right? Similarly, in sagittal section, the molars are parallel to the long axis of molar are parallel to the masseter so that they can bear the maximum load along the long axis. Okay, right? Now, this is about natural dentition. Do we have similar criteria, similar arrangement in our complete denture? Let's see. So this is the glass lab arrangement of the maxillary posteriors. You see, in sagittal section, as we go posteriorly, the molars are inclined distally. And in coronal section, the molars are inclined buccally. This is similar to our natural dentition. So can we say that the natural dentition and our complete denture have similar arrangement? No. There is a very big difference between these two, and that is this Christensen phenomenon. Christensen phenomenon says that when we protrude the mandible in natural dentition, edge to edge position, there is a constant gap. There is a separation of teeth in posterior region. Now, this is in natural dentition. Do we have Christensen phenomenon in complete denture? No, because in complete denture, we want bilaterally simultaneous anteroposterior contacts in all the excursive movement of the mandible. That is called as balanced occlusion. We have balanced occlusion in complete denture, but not in our natural dentition. So how do we bypass this Christensen phenomenon in complete denture? Actually, we compensate this Christensen phenomena with the use of compensatory curves. So the definition itself says that the compensatory curves compensate for the opening influence produced by the condyle and incisor guidance during lateral and protrusive mandibular eccentric movements, right? And they are only available, they are only present in construction of complete removable dental prosthesis. So the compensatory curves are responsible for the compensation of our Christensen phenomena. Now, what are these compensatory curves? Let's talk about them. So you must have learned about the Monson's theory of spherical occlusion, right? What does it say? It says that when we draw a sphere of 4-inch radius with the center at the glabella, the surface of the sphere occupies, or the occlusal surface of all the teeth falls on the surface of the sphere, right? This is the Monson's theory of spherical occlusion. Suppose we check this part of the sphere, we get a three-dimensional curve, right? And this three-dimensional curve is made up of two curves, that is anteroposterior curve and mediolateral curve. This three-dimensional curve is called as curve of Monson. The anteroposterior curve is called as curve of Spee, and the mediolateral curve is called as curve of Wilson. So this is Monson curve. It is three-dimensional. That is, it is also present in sagittal section as well as in frontal section. In sagittal section, we can see that all the teeth fall on the sphere. And in frontal section, the molar is falling on the sphere surface. You can see the direction of molars, right? They are following our complete denture as well as our natural dentition. Second is anteroposterior curve. Now, anteroposterior curve is called as curve of Spee. It starts from the tip of the canine, goes to distal cusp of the molar, and ends in the most anterior part of the condyle. So, this anteroposterior curve is called as the curve of Spee. Second is mediolateral curve, that is the curve of Wilson. It starts from the buccal cusp of the molar, ends to buccal cusp of opposite molar, and this makes a concave upward type of curve. That is the curve which have concave surface upward. Now, if you are confused between convex and concave surface in Wilson's curve, just remember this diagram. See this W for Wilson. This W has concave surface upward and convex surface downward. So, in Wilson curve, we have concave surface upward, concave surface, convex surface downward, and it is mediolateral curve. Another curve is curve of pleasure. This curve of pleasure is responsible for the stability of the denture. If you see here, the second premolar is tilted little bit buccally. The first molar is straight and second molar is tilted little bit lingually, like this. So this is the curve representing the pleasure curve, which states that to balance the complete denture, suppose this is the direction of force in buccal direction, right? In the second molar area. So to balance it, we have to provide a buccal inclination of premolar in the second premolar area so that they can cancel out each other and we can have a balance. We can have the balance, right? So this is the pleasure curve. It is formed at the bicuspid area, that is second premolar is in buccal inclination, first molar is straight, and second molar is the lingually inclined. It follows the curve of Wilson, whereas this is anti-Monson curve at the second premolar area. So now let's understand how this compensating curve works. Suppose this was initial stage, this dotted line. This was initial incisor inclination. This was initial compensating curves, and we have same condylar guidance. Now, suppose the incisor guidance is increased or it is getting steeper. When this happens, there will be posterior desocclusion, right? Because the incisor guidance is steeper now. So how can we make these molars contact? How can we again make them contact so that we can have balanced occlusion? We can tilt this molar little bit medially and this molar little bit distally. We have to tilt this molar, right? So we can do this. Now you see these molars are touching. These premolars are also touching. So the compensating curves, which was before, it was here. Previously, it was here. Now it has become more steeper, right? So with increase in the incisal guidance, our compensating curves are also getting steeper. And this is how we are getting balanced occlusion in the complete denture. I hope you have understood the concept. And if you have any suggestion or query, you can let me know in the comment section. Thank you.